American Russian Radio.
Back in the USSR!
Привет, я Юра Агеев, и это 47-й выпуск подкаста Make Sense. Вместе с гостями подкаста мы говорим о том, что играет важную роль при создании и развитии продуктов. Люди, идеи, деньги, инструменты и практики. И сегодня мой собеседник Мэтт Воллард. Мы поговорим о том, почему изменение поведения – ключевая задача любого продукта. Разберемся, с чего начать проектирование поведения и как в этом может помочь модель Competing Pressures. А еще обсудим, как измерять поведение и действовать, отталкиваясь от цифр. Подкаст выходит при поддержке Product Sense – конференции о менеджменте продуктов. Следующая конференция пройдет 28 и 29 октября 2019 года в Минске.
Hi, Matt.
Good morning, Yuri. How are you doing, man?
All good, and you?
I'm good. It's a beautiful sunny day here in New York City, and I'm glad to be talking to you. I haven't seen you in a little while.
Yeah, a couple months. So, let's start at the end. You've got a book a couple of weeks ago, yeah?
Yeah, I had a book come out. It's funny, everybody's been making start at the end jokes, and I realize I just don't have a good sense of humor. I realized that it would have been really good to put like an Easter egg at the end of the book. Everybody's joking about like how they should start the book at the end. And I feel like I should have made the last page say like, accept this book, idiot. But I just, you know, I missed the opportunity. So second printing, I'm going to have to screw around.
That's great. Great idea, actually, you know, because I haven't read your book yet. But I've read the title, How to Build Products That Change Behavior. And I remember in the other book by Matthew Kagan, How to Create Products Customers Love. So why should you build products that change behavior if you're already building products? You can build product that customer loves.
Well, so it's actually a very different goal to me. I think I was actually talking to someone the other day. This is going to be a wildly inappropriate example, but I think it works. I was talking to someone the other day about the difference. They had a crush on their mentor. And they were like, well, mentorship is kind of like dating. And I said, no, not at all, right? Your mentor is motivated by your success. Your romantic partner is motivated by your happiness. And those are very different things. There's a very big difference between making a product that a user likes or even wants, per se, and making a product that helps the user do resolve their sort of core motivations, right? I don't always like going to the gym, but I still go. And liking is important, I don't think it's actually an essential ingredient of all products, far from it. Instead, I think the point of everything that we build is in fact to change behavior. I'm sitting in a chair right now. I wouldn't say I like this chair, right? I don't even have any particular emotional attachment to this chair. And my world maybe would be better if I wandered around liking chairs, but liking actually uses up cognitive resources that I'd rather hoard for the things I really do like talking to you, right? I don't wanna like this chair. I don't need to like this chair. Liking this chair is actually a distraction from the things I really do want to like, the things I want to put emotional energy into. And yet I still need a chair, and I need a chair that causes me to sit, that changes my behavior. So I think that liking is just the wrong goal. It's not a bad goal, it's just the wrong goal.
But you said that every product, like the main goal of the product is to change some behavior of yours. Like the chair, it was built for sitting. So it's in some ways, it's already changing your behavior. Why should we think to make it our goal to change some behavior?
Because if we acknowledge that every product exists to change behavior, then what better goal is there in product than actually that behavior change? It's measurable, it's observable. I can have a 0-1 test for a better product because a better product is not subjectively defined, but objectively defined by the thing that makes me sit at the optimal ratio, right? Sit in the optimal amount. Now, liking may be a stop on the way, but ultimately, it's about sort of monitoring for that behavior change. Because if we acknowledge that that's the point of everything, why not start there, right? Not with the chair, not with it needs to have four legs and a seat and whatever, because we may want to challenge those notions. I don't think that's a word. Those notions. But instead, to start at the end allows us to create things that haven't existed before, not by simply mimicking what has already been created, but starting at the first principle of, well, what is it we're trying to have happen? What will be true when this product exists, right? I like sci-fi, and I always tell product designers they should read and watch sci-fi professionally, because sci-fi is about the world being fundamentally different in some principled way. And I think that's actually what product design is. Product design is envisioning a world in which a behavior has changed, understanding why we're in the world and the behavioral state that we are now, and then building a project, a product that bridges the two, that creates the behavior, creates this alternate universe.
How can you measure the behavior?
Well, I think it depends on the behavior. So we actually, in the book, I talk about writing a behavioral statement. So upfront, creating a behavioral goal that encoded into it has a few properties. One of them is the population. Whose behavior are you trying to change? So when a population has a motivation, what is the key need that causes a person to want to do this in the first place? And then the limitations, right? So what are the 0-1 binary things that must be true in order to utilize this or end up in this behavioral state? So if you wanted to use Uber in the early days, for example, you had to have an electronic form of payment, right? Because there was no other way to do it. So if you didn't have an electronic form of payment, you simply couldn't use the app, right? Even a phone ownership, right? You can't use an app if you don't have a phone. So, and then you need to articulate the behavior, you know, whatever it is, sitting in the chair, taking a ride, talking to you, right? Those are all behaviors as measured by some data. And that should be observable, right? As measured by some data is actually key, because it gets us away from things that bosses often say, like, well, I want people to love the product. That doesn't mean anything to me. I don't know what love looks like. When you say love the product, what do you mean? You mean use the product? You mean refer the product to somebody else? You mean pay for the product? Those are all different ideas of love, but very different behaviors and designed for very differently. I wouldn't build the same product to get somebody to refer versus use versus pay for.
Back at the conference, you talked about pressures as a... get it correctly, it's like the competing pressures model about promoting and inhibiting ones. How these pressures can help someone to change someone else's behavior?
Yeah, sure. So remember my earlier example about sci-fi, right? We're trying to get from the world that we have to the world that we want. Well, the way to do that is to understand. So once you've articulated, the behavioral statement articulates the world that we want. So the next thing you need to do is understand, well, why do we have the world that we have, right? People, I think, often miss this key and critical step, which is existing behavior is shaped by a world. It's shaped by existing products. It's shaped by existing motivations and limitations and populations. We have an existing world. And so the best way to get to the world that we want is to understand, well, what pressures shaped the world as it is? And so there are, as you mentioned, promoting pressures, things that make a behavior more likely, and inhibiting pressures, things that make a behavior less likely. And so by manipulating those pressures, we actually move people from world A to world B. Right, it's only through pressure change that we actually create that secondary world.
Okay, and can you give me more examples for promoting pressures, for example?
Sure, 100%. So promoting pressures, again, anything that makes a behavior more likely. Those can be very logical, sort of, you know, getting paid to do something could be a promoting pressure. Brand can be a promoting pressure. Enjoyment can be a promoting pressure. All of those things can be promoting pressure. Identity is a very powerful promoting pressure, right? Something being congruent with who I am and how I think of myself and my status in the world or my aspirational status in the world. Those are all powerful promoting pressures. And then opposing those, you have inhibiting pressures, right? Cost, availability, time that you need to spend on something. Again, identity, right? There may be things that are incompatible with my identity, things that I don't feel comfortable with. All of those compete. You can sort of think about it. I often think about it like quite literally and quite physically, right? If you have something sort of suspended in space, you sort of push things up on it and it will rise, or you can push down on it and it will sink, right? Like a bobber at the top of a bathtub, right? And so our job as product designers is to find, okay, what things make it float up and what things sort of push down on top of it. And there's always, inhibiting pressures are natural often. So there is a very short list of things I'm currently doing in the world. Wearing pants, talking to you, sitting in a chair. There's a very long list of things I'm not doing at this moment, skydiving, going for a walk, wearing a thorny crown, right? There's lots of things that theoretically one could be doing that one is not doing. And the reason those don't naturally occur all of the time is because everything has inhibiting pressure. It takes work, it takes mental energy. And I only have a limited pool of mental energy. And so our job as product designers is often to harness existing powerful promoting pressures like identity, and then remove as many inhibiting pressures as possible. How can I make it ridiculously easy? I think one of the things that many product designers miss is this notion of removing inhibiting pressures. If something is even mildly attractive and costs nothing, is totally available, and I don't have to think about it, it will just automatically happen. Breathing is the ultimate product. If you know, it has high promoting pressures, it's necessary for the sustaining of life, and I've spend zero cognitive energy thinking about it. It's totally non-conscious. My body does it automatically, separated from my brain. My nerves do it, right? Like, so I think I often try and challenge product designers that are working with me to think about, like, how do you make the breathing of the product that you're trying to make? How do you make something so automatic and so transparent that you don't need strong promoting pressures? You don't need a big push. You just need a little bit of ease.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's like some kind of positive and negative motivation. And if you will talk about like promoting pressures, so it's easy to imagine how can you measure it. For example, if you're talking about money or something else. But I wonder, in your book, like what was the inhibiting pressure for you to write it?
Oh my gosh! I mean, right, the inhibiting pressures to writing a book are very, very high. Right. And it depends even to how you define write a book, right? First of all, there's bringing it to market, which, you know, is very hard. How do you get it on Amazon, right? Like, it's not like I just write a book and it magically appears, right? For me, there's a publisher involved, right? Penguin Random House, who's been great to me. But, you know, there are all sorts of inhibiting pressures to the launch and release of a book. But even the writing takes time. It takes structure. It, you know, you have to, it takes a program, ironically, you know, right? Like, nobody thinks about that. Nobody thinks about, like, oh, you could just whip open Word. But is Word, like, the best way to write a book? Script writers and other things have developed their own software precisely because if you do something professionally a lot, you may need to develop custom software in order to do it. And I think that's really interesting. So, you know, there were tons of inhibiting pressures. I have a small child who's, you know, almost four. The book took much longer than I expected just because I was busy sort of caring for him. There's all sort of competing pressures, competing demands for my time, alternative pathways of behavior. And so, you know, if you wanted to get everyone in the world to write a book, you'd probably assign them a ghostwriter, right? It's very easy to answer questions and then you don't need software and, you know, it's pretty time efficient. You know, someone else adds the structure, right? And increasingly, I think many books are being written that way. Other people are providing the structure precisely because I think it's actually quite hard to do it. I mean, I think everyone thinks they have a book in them somewhere. Right, it's one of the most common things that I think is true of people, that everybody secretly in their heart, in the way that we're the hero of our own stories, everybody believes there's a book in there somewhere. But very few people actually get the damn thing out, right? It's so hard to sit down and carve out the time to write something that long and that structured, let alone something worth reading, right? That has all of the necessary promoting pressures, entertainment and readability and sort of knowledge transfer and all those things that actually get somebody to read the book. And hopefully I've done that, but you never really know until you see the behavior. And that's actually the lovely thing about science, right? Sort of the science of behavior change. You asked earlier, why should we start with behavior change? Well, one of the nice things about behavior change is by having an objective outcome, an objective behavior that you can measure, you can actually science your way to product, right? You can tweak something, release a version, see if it changes behavior. Tweak something, release a version, see if it changes behavior, right? And there's an objective standard for a better version. The better version is the thing that changes behavior. And so, you know, if I could... It's tough with a book, right? You can only release it once. But I did things like, I had people who have never been exposed to my work read earlier drafts, and then I quizzed them on what they got out of it. And if they didn't get out what I had sort of intended to put in, then I tweaked the book, and I tweaked the book, and I tweaked the book. And there was sort of a process to trying to get so that that you remember and actually practice what I do at the... what I'm suggesting in the book, this sort of behavioral design process. And I think that was actually kind of fun for me. It was sort of, I think, probably a novel way for people to write books, but having people read and, what did this make you think? What did it make it feel? Did you notice yourself doing anything differently? When did you remember things, right? Became really interesting for me to hear and gave me a lot of feedback on, like, how else to communicate. And I've tried to write a book that is very pithy for that reason. But I don't think that people get engaged with their products. They fall so far in love with whatever the heck it is that they built, right? I love this book, and so I'm not going to change anything. Well, then you're not much of a product designer.
Yeah, sure. So you was trying to change the people's behavior after they are reading the book.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, the whole point of the book is not... It's ironic, actually. I think many people think the point of a book is to be read. And that's not true at all, right? If you read one word of it, but it managed to change your behavior, right? If you just read inhibiting pressure, promoting pressure, you read four words, but magically you knew what that meant and you went and changed your behavior in the world, well, that's a successful book. I don't need you to read every single word, right? The book is interestingly phrased in two halves, for example. The first half is very well structured into sort of explaining the intervention design process. The second half is sort of a series of case studies and deep dives into other things. And I actually recommend that people, hey, if you're not ready, don't read the second half. If you're still chewing on the first half, don't read the second half. You can always come back to it. the point is very much about, you know, changing behavior. And I think people get frustrated by that. Bad product designers often get frustrated by that. They're like, why aren't people using my thing? Who cares? Who cares if they're not using your thing if it accomplished the behavior that you wanted, right? That's super, you know, they did it once and it changed their behavior and now they don't need it anymore. Wasn't that a very successful product?
Yeah, it's a good question. So let's get to your work. Now you're working at Cover Health. It's insurance company, am I right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 100%. So I'm the chief behavioral officer at Clover Health. I have a team of about 8 behavioral scientists that roll up to me that are project managers, qualitative researchers, and quantitative researchers.
Okay, great. So the insurance itself is like a really old industry, and people know a lot about insurance, like to why should you do it and why should you not do it, and how the behavioral science help you at your work.
Yeah, so I work at Clover is a very particular kind of insurance. It's something called Medicare Advantage. So it's health insurance. And in order to be eligible for it, you have to be either over 65 or disabled. And so it's government-sponsored insurance that is administered by a private company, in this case, Clover. And so my work isn't generally about why to uptake insurance, right? This is insurance you get more or less automatically. You can get it from us or you can get it from the government. But instead about how do you actually bend the risk curve of insurance by changing behavior? How do you make people healthy? And I think your point about knowledge is really interesting, right? We know theoretically quite a lot about how do you go and make people healthy, right? We know a lot about the science of health. We know how eating particular things or not eating particular things will affect your health, or doing things or not doing things will affect your health, smoking, exercise, etc. But the hard part has always been getting people to actually do those things. How do you get people to stop smoking? How do you get people to go to the gym? How do you get people to eat the right foods or take their medication? I mean, one of the great unsolved problems of modern medicine, for example, which I think is almost laughable, but entirely true, is we keep making better and better pills, right? We're better and better at making medication, but they only work if people take them. And medication adherence routines are very, very bad. People are not very good at taking their medication on a regular basis. It's actually probably one of the number one problems of chronic illness is that we know we have medications that will help. We simply can't get people to take them on a regular and reoccurring basis. And so I think what's really, really interesting about that is, you know, how do you go like find ways to cause people to actually take their medicine and go to the gym and things. And so that's what the dominant majority of my team is. It is spending time on actually getting people to do the things that we know will make them healthy. I don't have to do much novel research about what will make them healthy. I have to do novel research about how do I actually get them to do it.
Yeah, that's true actually, because personal health is one hell of the promoting pressure for you. Should be at least. And but it's strange that people always forget about it.
Yeah, I think that actually, the point you just made is actually really interesting. And I think it's one people sometimes forget. I think people just have naively this assumption that, well, not dying is the ultimate promoting pressure, right? And yet it isn't really. If you wanted to maximize your chances of not dying, you would seal yourself in a barometric sort of chamber, be fed intravenously, right? Like you could live a really, really, really long time by doing nothing at all and sort of isolating yourself from the world. But that would be a very impoverished life. Not dying is not the point of life. Life is not simply, you know, sort of prolonging of itself. It's a series of experiences. And so what becomes very interesting is motivation is actually very key. A great example is like we did a bunch of work around the flu shot, and we're very successful this year in raising flu shot rates. And one of the reasons that we were able to do that is we stopped focusing on your individual health. What it turned out is when we say, hey, Yuri, you should get a flu shot so that you stay healthy, very, very few people engaged with that. People, it turns out, are very not motivated by the notion of their own health, in part because of poor effective forecasting. Oh, I'm healthy. I'll never get the flu. The flu's not that bad. It doesn't kill anybody, right? They have all these inappropriate stereotypes that cause them psychologically, as we know, built into their brain, right? People don't want to think about being sick, so they avoid they believe that it's low probability that they will be sick because they don't like thinking about it. But so the way that we actually raised so much or changed so much of the flu shot behavior is by appealing to motivations that dealt with other people's health or the secondary effects of you getting sick. So rather than saying, hey, Yuri, you should get a flu shot so you don't get sick, we measured why did people want to be healthy? We asked them what their personal health goal was. And once we understood their personal health goal, then we fed that back to them. So if Yuri said, hey, I really like to travel, we would say, you know, if you get the flu shot, if you get the flu, you can't travel, right? If you end up in the hospital, you're not allowed to leave, right? You're not allowed to leave the country, your travel will be restricted. If you already said, hey, what I really value is my independence and freedom, we would say, hey, you know the best way to lose your independence and freedom? Like, don't get your flu shot. And we could also do group-based stuff, right? So if they said, hey, what I really love is my grandkids, say, great. You know, the only way people get the flu is from someone who has the flu. And so, you know, your grandkids, kids are a vulnerable population of the flu. They have weaker immune systems. So get your flu shot to protect your grandkids. And it turns out, hey, if you say get your flu shot to protect yourself, nobody listens. But if you say, hey, you might inadvertently kill your grandkids if you don't get a flu shot, well, it turns out people listen.
Yeah. The last one is pretty strong. Okay.
Especially if we know that's what's important to you, right?
Yeah.
Even a trivial level of personalization, you know, which of these five things do you care about? Independence, travel, your kids, your grandkids, your spouse, your church congregation, all of these different sort of basic motivations. Then just whatever they say is theirs, great. I'll send you a letter tailored to that, right? Don't get your spouse sick. She's vulnerable. Don't get your spouse sick. He's vulnerable. Don't get your church congregation sick. You know, there are vulnerable people in it. All of those things are very interesting, easy ways to go about changing somebody's behavior. And, you know, incredibly inexpensive, right? We're talking about sending a written letter that's mildly personalized just because of some data collection, right? If you operationalize it correctly, you know, there's a ton that you can do just around manipulating very small promoting and inhibiting pressures that have very large outcomes.
That's interesting. And how the process builds in your company? How do you test these ideas? How do you collect them?
Yeah, sure. So this is sort of the first half of the book, you know, the notion of this sort of intervention design process. So I meet regularly with executives and other senior leaders about, you know, what are the goals of their various groups? What behaviors are they trying to change? What are they working on at the moment? And then we have a set number of slots where I'll assign a certain number of things. And then we run a 10-week process that includes sort of writing a behavioral statement, investigating the state of the current world. So what pressures exist that shape the current world? Then using those to design interventions and then actually running what we call pilots. So pilots are very small. They're not going to be quantitatively significant. They're just sort of dipping our toe in the water and saying like, hey, do we have the pressures right? Like what really works here? And when we find something that works, then we'll go run a larger test. You know, so a pilot might have 10, 20, 30 people in it. Test will have 100, 200, 300 people in it. And that's really where we start to work out the juice squeeze problem. So it's relatively easy to find interventions that change behavior. All interventions, however, are worth doing, meaning is the scope of the behavior change large enough to justify the cost of doing the intervention? And so tests are really where we sort of work out that juice squeeze. And then, you know, once we sort of figured out those two things, then we can go. The nice thing is you then can go to executives with a fairly clear statement that you can have some confidence in. You know, you could say, we are fairly confident that if you spend, you know, $1 million doing X, people will do Y, and that's kind of worth Z, right? And then executives can decide whether that fits in scope or not. And so it actually, I think, makes our CEO's job a lot easier when you're able to come to him with a book of interventions and say, okay, well, here are the 20 things that we have available to do. Pick which ones you want to do. But you're not just presenting them as good ideas. You're presenting them as things like where you know they're going to cost about this much and they're going to return about this much. And so you pick the ROI calculus that's right for you.
I'm trying to wrap my head around the narrative, like to change the behavior you want to change. And it's really actually harder to think in these terms.
Yes, 100%. I actually think that that's the most challenging thing for people. I think getting to behavior change, once you've figured out like what the behavior is you want to change, I think most good product people can build something that will change that behavior. The hard part is getting people to think about behaviors in the first place, right? That's one of the reasons the book ended up being called Start at the End and really focusing on the behavior change portion is because that's actually the hardest part is getting people to think in behavior. Product designers are used to thinking about what we build, the intervention. Not the outcome of what we build, right? The outcome is sort of secondary. And it's flipping that. It's putting the outcome as primary. Hey, this is what we want to have happen. And therefore, we need to do this. Instead of, well, here's the thing I think I want to build. Is that a good idea? You know, startup pitching is a great example of this. I've sat on so many startup pitching panels and things where, you know, they sort of say to me, well, we're thinking of building X. And they never say to me what they think that will do in the world, right? They never say, well, we're thinking of changing Y behavior and therefore we're going to build X. They just say we want to build X. And, you know, evaluating X as a good or bad idea is only possible in the context of behavior change, right? If you said, you know, is giving away free burgers a good idea? I have no idea if giving away free burgers is a good idea, McDonald's, right? Like, I have no idea. It depends. What is it you're trying to get people to do? If you're trying to get people to, you know, die of a heart attack, yeah, giving away free burgers is a great idea. If you're trying to sell more burgers, well, I'm not as convinced, right? Does that make sense?
I'm thinking about another narrative that product managers and designers usually using. It's like, what's the problem? What is the problem that we are trying to solve? So it's like the different narrative, what the behavior we want to change and what the problem we're trying to solve. So how...
Yeah, it's interesting, right? What people say, part of the problem is when people say, what is the problem we're trying to solve? They often start with the product that already exists. So they're sort of, what is the problem we're trying to solve? Well, people aren't buying our thing. Okay, well, buying our thing is a behavior, but have you decided like how you're quantifying that? When we're talking about people, who are we talking about? You know, why would they want to do that in the first place? What prevents them from doing that? And then adopting a systematic approach to doing that. You know, I think when people say, well, what is the problem? They often view the product as broken as opposed to the world as broken, right? Instead of we didn't achieve our outcome, something's wrong with the product that we built and we just need to fix that thing and then magically everything will be great. Maybe you built exactly the right product and it's just you're measuring the wrong behavior, mate. And you've created the wrong behavior change. I often talk about on stage about business model innovation, why I think business model innovation is so key and interesting. Sometimes you've built something that changes a behavior that wasn't the behavior that you intended. And so you need to change, you know, how you think about that behavior. It's interesting, actually. My first startup that I ever worked at, a place is called Thrive. It was founded by a guy named Avi Karnani and a guy named Ori Schnapps. And it was around personal finance. And everybody in the personal finance space thought they were going to make money off lead gen, right? So they thought the behavior of interest was getting people to uptake accounts that had lead gen dollars associated with them, right? They thought that was the behavior of interest. And that's not what anybody got bought for, right? Mint got bought for pure users, right? They got bought based on users and usage by Intuit, right? Who wanted users and usage that they could parlay into other products. We got bought by LendingTree for our ability to change people's financial behaviors, right? Raising their credit score, which helped them with their mortgage product. Nobody got bought for lead gen. And so if you had thought that the point of your product was to get people to uptake accounts, you would have built the wrong thing, right? If I had known at the beginning, well, the thing I'm trying to build is about raising people's credit scores, I might have built something different and better. But I was too busy thinking that my job was over here to like sell accounts, essentially.
But when you're thinking about the change in the behavior, it's harder to tie it like with money outcome or something, no? So it's like when you said like, well, I'm trying to build this thing, it will cost that and that, and we will make that much money. So it's like easier to calculate. But if you're talking about behavior, it's kind of not that predictable.
Well, so it's actually interesting. I mean, one of the things that we spend a lot of time on is quantifying the impact of behavior, right? I actually think that, you know, this is where Excel modeling and other things are really important. So a flu shot, for example, I know how much money I spend as an insurance company when people go to the hospital with the flu. So we literally pulled all of the transactions, you know, all of the claims records where people were admitted to the hospital with a flu. I know how effective the flu shot is in general in any given year. And I know how much it costs to administer. So I actually did the math. So I could say to an executive, each flu shot I get is approximately saves us about $100 in medical expense, right? Which for us is, you know, insurance is an interesting business, right? You're spending money to save money. It's not revenue. It's avoiding medical expense, right? I know how much it costs to go to the hospital. I know what these claims were worth. I know how many people got admitted to the hospital because they have the flu, and I know how much the flu shot will help them avoid going to the hospital. So I can do the math and say for every flu shot we deliver, that's worth X number of dollars.
Mm-hmm. And then you're saying that if you want to change this behavior, it will cost so much money and it will save us that. Okay. I'll get it. And let's get back to competing pressures model. From which pressures, like, should we start, like, the promoting one or inhibiting one?
Yeah, it's sort of a cheat, right? Like, you have to pay attention to both, right? So both of them matter. I will admit that I have a systematic bias for inhibiting pressures. I like inhibiting pressures. I think they're interesting for a couple of reasons. There's a whole chapter in the book on like why I'm in love with inhibiting pressures. I talk about the fact that they're, you know, promoting pressures tend to be heterogeneous. They're different between different people. Different people do a behavior for different reasons, but inhibiting pressures tend to be homogenous. We're all affected by availability. We're all affected by cost. We're all affected by time, right? And so when you reduce inhibiting pressures, you tend to get a greater span of behavior change across a wider population because everybody's affected. There are lots of reasons I'm interested. But the systematic thing, well, the thing that science would tell us is we've shown in my lab that when you when what you're trying to do is get people to do a behavior more often, people systematically are biased towards promoting pressures. They fixate on how do we reward people for doing it? How do we create stronger and stronger promoting pressures? And what that implies is that the untapped opportunity space is actually on the inhibiting pressure side, right? It's on the side that people aren't paying attention to, and vice versa for eliminating behavior. If you're trying to get people to stop smoking, everybody thinks about, well, I'll tax them and I'll make them illegal and I'll make it hard to smoke them and I'll show them lots of negative advertising. But nobody talks about, hey, well, maybe I'll just make them not cool in the first place, right? Everybody starts smoking because they think it's cool. Maybe I'll just make it not cool in the first place. And so I won't have that promoting pressure in the first place. And so I think what that implies is the opportunity space is virtually always on the opposite side of where you're looking, right? So if you're looking at creating behaviors, producing more of a behavior, then you should be looking at inhibiting pressures first. And if you're looking at eliminating a behavior, you should be looking at how you eliminate promoting pressures first. Just because systematically, that's the place where you and your competitors are most likely to have looked. That's why I actually, you know, advocate getting in a room and actually drawing an up arrow and a down arrow so that you get things on both sides of the equation. You force people to really look at both sides of the equation.
Okay, and we have all these products like Instagram and Facebook, and they have like the promoting pressure for you, like getting likes, getting recognized or something. And in some way, it is a behavioral change in like white population. There is like the ethical part of it. The more people are willing to spend more time in this application, and it's like not really good for the society in general. So
yeah, it's interesting. So I think there's a whole chapter in the book on ethics, both of the sort of, and I think there's two kinds of ethics. There's ethics of the intervention. So meaning, is this an okay intervention given my behavioral goal? And then there's ethics of the behavioral goal, right? Like if your behavioral goal is to get people to start smoking, right, then there are ethical challenges to the behavior you want to create in the first place, let alone how you go about creating it. So I think that both can occur. You know, I think ethics is hard to do internally. That's why one of the reasons that open science is so important, you know, ethics gets better when we are forcing people to be diligent and rigorous about thinking about and appropriately sort of articulating to the world in general what they want to do and how they're doing it. I think one of the biggest problems of Facebook is it isn't clear what Facebook is trying to achieve, right? What is the behavioral outcome of Facebook? I don't think even they know that. And I think that that's a huge problem, right? How can you design a product where you don't know the behavioral outcome? I think individual product managers know the individual product or individual behavior they care about. My job is to get people to log in. My job is to get people to post. My job is to get people to like. But I don't think anybody at the top has looked and said, like, well, how are all of these behaviors coming together? What is the macro behavior that we're trying to change?
Well, they're saying their goal, like, to create more connections between people.
But that's not a behavior, right? Like that's part of the problem, right? This is I hate these sort of fluffy mission-y statement kind of things because that's not actually a behavior. When you say create connections between people, what do you mean? You mean people see each other more often? They talk to each other more often? They talk to each other in a more meaningful way? What does connection mean? What does people mean, right? If I was talking to a bot, but I was very emotionally revelatory, would that accomplish Facebook's goal? Would they be okay with that? Would they say that was a yes or a no? Having done this many, many times with many, many executives, you know, part of the job of good product design is sort of to push people to articulate that, right? So I often sort of challenge executives, well, you know, X would fall within, you know, you articulated a behavior, X would fall within it. Like, would you say that that's true? Let's take a really basic one. If Facebook wants to facilitate connections between people, if I kill you, I have a connection with you. So is the point of Facebook getting people to kill each other? Is that the new motto?
I hope not.
I hope not as well. And I think that they would intuitively and instinctively say, no, that's not the point, right? That's not what we mean. Well, great, but it is encapsulated by what you said, right? And words have meaning. So if that's not what you mean, let's talk about what you mean, right? What is it you actually mean when you say connection, right? Because killing each other, you know, that creates a connection between us. What is it when you actually mean when you say connection? And getting people to articulate what that looks like in the world, how it's measurable, what's observable. Part of the problem of connections is how the hell do you measure we want people to be more connected, right? If you don't know what that means in the world, you can't possibly measure it. And if you can't possibly measure it, you can't design for it. You can't use science, right? If you don't know, if you cannot measure something, you cannot run a scientific process to create it because you don't know what it is you're trying to do.
But we must admit, like, the Facebook and Instagram and WhatsApp and all these applications, they're really good. And what you called product must talk to people at identity. And these products are really good at it. Like, for example, Instagram. Like, it's really good to have a connection with people.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, so certainly I would agree that they are. One of the things that social networking did was create identity-relevant products in a time where weren't nearly enough of them. Right, Instagram, what Instagram actually does well is allow you to express your identity or a version of your identity, or more probably your aspirational identity. What Instagram does is say, I don't have to express my real life. I can express the curated version of my life that I want to project, right? Which is tale as old as time, right? Like, people have been manipulating the public impression of themselves forever, right? You know, whether it was actually broke, but driving a fancy car, right? Like, I think since the beginning of time, people have been trying to show themselves as better than they are. And Instagram just took that and ran with that ball, right? Allowed you to present whatever you wanted, right? And it's interesting, you know, there's been a change where young people are preferring, the young audiences on Instagram are preferring less high quality content, meaning they don't want it to look produced. They want it to look sort of amateur and authentic and whatever, because they're very wary of anything that looks overproduced. But even that is its own kind of constraint, right? Even that is its own kind of conceit. How do you make something look the right kind of not good? You know, it is all about playing with identity. But what does Instagram want to get people to do, right? What should be true in the world because Instagram exists? I think Instagram doesn't know the answer to that question. I think it's part of the problem of the product and the platform, you know. And I think it's still a young enough platform. It's weird to say that. I think people think of these as very old platforms, but it's still a young enough platform that problem, I think, has not yet been surfaced. If you look at something older like Twitter, one of the problems of Twitter, the recent crises of Twitter, is that Twitter didn't know, and I don't think does know, what they want people to do because of Twitter. What should be true in the world because of Twitter? The facilitation of knowledge sharing? Is it the spread of information? Is it the expression of identity? Is it the debate around opinion? Like, what is it that people should do because Twitter exists other than tweet, right? Other than the mere usage of the product, what should be true in the world because of Twitter? You know, one could argue we elected a very bad president in my country because of social media, because social media enabled a certain kind of grouping and a certain kind of spreading and a certain kind of misinformation. But I don't think anybody... I don't think Facebook or Instagram's founders would have said, yeah, I'm founding Twitter. I don't think Jack would have been like, yeah, I'm creating Twitter so that we'll elect a dictatorial, idiotic president, right? And I think that because they didn't articulate what it was, what they wanted to be true because of it, then anything could be true because of it. And generally the negative will be true in there somewhere.
But don't you think that's because this is like the social networks and the people usually decide what to do with it? Like what the outcome will be, no? Why?
I call bullshit on that, right? Any of these sort of like, well, I'm just a platform and people decide what to do with it. No, you guided people to do a particular thing. When you started saying that the metric of success was attention, likes from people you've never fucking met, then you created a system that encourages, that creates promoting pressures around the spread of misinformation, high attention grabbing. You created a system that does these things. Now, those you may not consciously or intentionally have done that, but you still created a system. It's not just like, oh, you put a blank page out into the world that people started writing, right? You created a system and you are responsible for its usage. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, these are not simply blank pages. It's not like you handed people a white piece of paper and said, go make things. And even if you did, you know, hand people a white piece of paper and a black piece of paper are very different. They make people create different kinds of things. They even literally change the way that we see the world, right? If you give people a white piece of paper, they see the world in contrast, right? They see the world in sort of, you know, shadow and light, right? That's not always how people perceive the world, or it wasn't the only way to perceive the world, and great painters, part of the point of great artists is actually that they've changed our perception around those things. They haven't used shadow and light. They have used other kinds of things, right? Like they've sort of challenged those notions of what is basic and fundamental. So I don't think it's simply true that, hey, you put out a platform and people do what they want to do with it. No, you encouraged people to do a particular kind of thing with it. Facebook started on college campuses. It started with a very particular kind of motif, a very particular kind of momentum that was about meeting people on your college campus and connecting to people on your college campus. That is very, very different, intentionally different, createdly different than the platform that elected Trump.
Yeah, there's the thing. When you're creating something like that, but they don't know that it will be so big. But when you're just starting to create, you just doesn't think about behavior, you know? You just want to do something.
Exactly. You get obsessed with the intervention, right? I think of this thing that allows, that connects people should exist. And so I'm going to go build this thing that connects people instead of what is the point of this thing that connects people. You know, I often think of it like a pencil, right? People love to pivot from the back of the pencil. In reality, you should be pivoting from the front of the pencil. Think about a pencil. Think about how you write. When you think about how you write, you think about the end that is near you, right? The eraser side, how your hand is going to move it. But ultimately, it's about the outcome. It's about how does the tip at the end move? And so we have to start from that tip at the end. We have to start from that place where pencil meets paper, because you know, you can design wildly different kinds of writing implements that might even work better than a pencil if you focus on, well, what does it take to create, you know, the mark on the page? And I think that is where so many of these things go wrong. And you know, when we talk about platforms in particular as a great example, like the way that we know that they were designed and created a behavior is because we can imagine a different design, right? We can imagine social networks that don't look like the social networks that we have. We can imagine social networks that wouldn't have elected Trump. And so we can imagine alternatives that says that, well, we can design for alternatives. If we can imagine a different behavior, we can design for it. That's why I go back to the sci-fi thing, right? Like, if we can imagine a world in which we don't use social networks to spread disinformation or cause people to do group-based identity or whatever, well, we could design for that. I'll give you actually a perfect example. It is likely true that we wouldn't have elected Trump if there were not such things as private groups, if there was no notion of grouping, right? So in early Facebook, there was no group, right? There was just you, the individual connecting with other individuals at your school on your network, right? That was the individual sort of model of a social network, was individual nodes connecting with each other. And then Facebook and others created the idea of groups. Right? It said, no, you can go find other people who have an affinity that you have. And it is highly likely that choice has a direct connection to the election of Trump, right? The ability to say, hey, all you racists, you can get together. You don't have to be a racist alone. You can be a racist around other people who will reward you for being a racist. And so we could track back to features that allowed for this sort of thing. And there are ways that we could have combated that, I think. J. Nathan Mathis has done amazing work on how, you know, he created sort of bots and things on Reddit that he can show produced more ethical behavior that caused people to be less trolly, less other kinds of things by creating sort of ethic-based things. And I think that it's really quite amazing how much can be done if people just don't get fixated on the sort of what exists and the natural consequence of social networks. You know, whenever I'm always leery when people step back and say, well, I'm not responsible for the thing that was created by my thing. Well, at that point, you're no longer a product designer, right? The moment you say this behavior is outside of my control, then, you know, you sort of take off your hat and go home, as far as I'm concerned, right? Everything can be designed for, all behaviors can be designed for. And so it is on all of us to not opt out and to say, no, I can create things that create better behaviors and create the behaviors I want.
Yeah, that's a great idea. And I like the quotes of you from the conference. It says, find the system that works for you, but use the system. It was your answer for the question about how the jobs to be done, customer discovery, customer development, and all these kind of things. Like can be used to behavioral change. And you said that it really doesn't matter, but if you use system and it's work, just use it. So yeah, that's the idea. And I want you like to reflect one more time on this.
Yeah, I mean, so for me it was, right, all, when we talk about jobs to be done or start at the end or any of the models for actually doing this, we're trying to create a behavior. I'm trying to get you to create products that create change, right? And so if you read my book and then you read something by Clay and Clay causes you to change behavior more, fantastic, right? You've accomplished my goal. My goal wasn't use my thing. My goal was change behavior. And so if something else better than my thing, other than my thing, causes you to create behavior, fantastic. I always say that one of the signs of a good product designer is, and I ask people in interviews to sort of think really hard about this. Imagine that you were working really hard on a behavioral problem and you came in the next day and someone else had built something that solved it. how would you feel? And if you think you would be devastated by that, crushed by that, then you're not a good product designer. You should go find another career, right? Good product designers, sure, you might feel a momentary twinge of regret about the time that you spent on it, but you should be happy because now you get to go solve some other problem, right? You should have a, you know, the list of behaviors I want to change is very, very, very long. And so I'm happy when anybody, you know, every time you change a behavior for me, that's just one less I have to do. That seems amazing to me. I'm all for that. And so, you know, to me, I think, you know, people try and one of the natural things that people try to do in an attention-driven world is spark controversy, right? I think people want Clay Christensen and I to like go at each other and debate whether my model or his model is better, right? And I just refuse to engage in that. I think it's just spurious and reductive. I think it doesn't matter if his model is better or my model is better. What matters is that you know, we get people to change the way that they build things. And as long as they're, you know, sort of creating behavioral outcomes, I'm fine with whatever.
Cool. And have you tried to use this model on yourself, like to change your personal behavior?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'm not a self-helpy kind of guy. My behavior as it naturally exists is more or less the behavior that I kind of go with. I don't have many behaviors that I want to change. But when I do want to change a behavior, and often when I, you know, a great recent example, when I want to change behavior, usually these days it's about being a better parent. Right. So I think about my son and I think about like, how can I hold on 1 second? Let's just let this siren go by. Hold on. So lately, you know, one of the things I think about changing my own behavior around is often around my son. How do I be a better dad? How do I be more patient? How do I be more engaged? How do I do those things? And so that is the place where I spend, you know, time thinking about behavior change. And I absolutely use this. Right. So one of the things that I do is I have two phones. I have a work phone and a personal phone. And on work phones, on weekends, I just literally shut off my work phone and put it away in my bag. And I don't look at it while Bear's awake. Once he goes to bed, I'll check in and see how work's going, but I just don't look at my phone. And I think people, this is an amazingly powerful hack, because one of the things that causes you to look at your phone and lose focus on your kid is, well, I'm just gonna check in on work really briefly, just 10 seconds, I'm gonna check in on work, and then work sucks you in. Right, as it tends to do. And so I think that for me, at least, it, you know, it's little hacks like this, spending time on figuring out, hey, what are the promoting pressures of the behaviors that I don't want? You know, how can I eliminate them? It is really key to being a better parent. So I do sort of hack on my parenting using promoting and inhibiting pressures all the time.
Great. I think that's all for this time. Thank you, Matt. Thanks for sharing. I love to talk to you and looking forward to see you again.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's your turn to come this way.
Sure,
but I'm sure I'll get over to Russia again at some point. Throw another great conference, and I'll have a reason to come over. I think my visa's good for like 3 years or something, right? It's all time to come back. Well, Yuri, thanks for chatting with me, man. And I'll send this recording over.
Yeah, thanks. Bye.
Итак, в этом выпуске подкаста Make Sense вместе с Мэттом Уоллертоном. Мы поговорили о том, почему изменение поведения – ключевая задача любого продукта. Разобрались, с чего начать проектирование поведения и как в этом может помочь модель Competing Pressures. А еще обсудили, как измерять поведение и действовать, отталкиваясь от цифр. Подкаст выходит при поддержке Product Sense – конференция о менеджменте продуктов. Следующая конференция пройдет 28 и 29 октября 2019 года в Минске. Это был 47-й выпуск подкаста Make Sense и его ведущий Юра Агеев. Подписывайтесь, ставьте лайки и присылайте обратную связь. Спасибо, что были с нами. До следующего выпуска. Пока!